Afternoon and welcome to the fourth talk of Pani Pe Charcha, the clean water talks that is being held under the USAID supported program with Safe Water Network called SEWA. SEWA stands for Sustainable Enterprises for Water and Health. Today we have the pleasure of a talk with Aarti Verma from Water Life. She'll be talking about mobilization of ecosystems to create sustainable water ATMs. This talk is further to the talk which was held by Nandi Community Water Systems, where Nandi spoke about the role of community mobilization and IEC. Today, we will hear what are the steps that are taken by the Safe Water Enterprise practitioners to institutionalize themselves in the communities so that there is strong ownership and sustainability of water ATMs. With me is Mr. Anand Rudra from USAID. Anand Rudra is senior WASH specialist. He has worked on water and sanitation, not only in India, but also with Southeast missions of the USAID. I am your host, Poonam Sevak from Safe Water Network. Safe Water Network is working on policy advisory, piloting solutions for affordable safe water for the communities which are at the bottom of the pyramid, leading the Safe Water Enterprise Alliance and supporting technical capacity building in the government. Let me introduce you to our speaker, Aarti, CSR business lead at Water Life India. Aarti has been working at Water Life India for last 5 years. Prior to this, she was working with AC Nielsen's in primary research consulting. She has worked across a variety of sectors, including FMCG, telecom, and retail. Aarti holds a degree in life sciences from St. Xavier's College, Mumbai, and a postgraduate diploma in business management from Sydenham Institute of Management. Water Life India has been setting up water ATMs across 15 states of India since 2008. They have more than 700 community water centers, primarily for purification of arsenic and fluoride from groundwater. Besides having their water ATMs in the states of Bihar, West Bengal, they are having their flagship program in Puducherry state, where they are working for safe water access across the entire city network. They are also working in a similar fashion with the urban municipalities of Tamil Nadu. Over to Aarti now.
So I think the thing is that for all of us, as you know, being in this field for so many years, I think we all do have very strong technical expertise in terms of setting up water treatment plants, and in terms of being servicing them, operating them, etc. However, one of the things where some of our plants do better and some of our plants are not able to do better is actually not so much the infrastructure part of it, but it is really to do with the community and how we can really get the community to adopt. Because while our technical solution, we can easily customize, standardize it, etc., community solution has to be a little more thought through, and customization is required at every which may be quite different for everything. And so we really, but some steps can be common, and so that is what we're really going to go through, and then we will see it through one of the examples today. So basically, for any community mobilization effort, the thing is that when you set up your program, it has to generate interest. They have to trust you, and they have to then engage with you on a long term basis. So these all of these elements now become a little difficult because you're from outside the community. You're going in as an outsider. You may have carry a lot of experience, but the community doesn't know you, and you have to build that. Every project you have to in a way build it ground up, right? So that is where the role of the community itself comes in, and how can we leverage what the existing networks and you can say influencers in the community are, and how can we leverage them so that we can the interest, trust, engagement we can start building through existing community networks and influence touch points. And because in the end the medium is also the message, so I mean how you're going, through whom you're going matters as much as the fact that what you're talking about, your program. So this is really what we kind of take as the framework of what we want to do in any community mobilization. So some of the key steps really are, first of all, understanding the community and let's say existing power structures. This could be the formal power structures or the formal channels through whom you already have kind of liaising with, maybe the municipal administration or the panchayat, but even all the informal power structures which may exist. So you need to understand, and you need to take them on board as well, because that in the end otherwise there are going to be long term some issues. And we always approach it as that this is a program which is for your community. This is a program by your community, because we collaborate with the panchayat or the municipal administration, and we are here only to implement and run it. And hence we are fairly in that sense a neutral implementation partner. And that's how we kind of project it right up front, when we are meeting with the different stakeholders or the formal and informal power structures. Then it is of course seeing what are the other channels of touch points and trust and influence that exists, and how we can kind of connect them into our ecosystem and build a ecosystem around our plant, so that we are in a way entrenched and integrated within the community itself, and we're not seen to be outsiders who come in kind of set up shop. So that's really important for us. And so what are the shared goals of each of those channels, and how together we are working towards a similar shared goal. And of course there will be traditional outreach channels, door to door. Again, what we look for is how can we get the community to participate, to get a little more engaged. What are the bonding opportunities we can create through our program? And also that within communities there may be certain, again, even more marginalized communities, are we even reaching out to those communities? So these are some of the key steps that we follow, and I'll just take you through one example of our plant in Navi Mumbai. And through that, you can see how we are, doing this community ecosystem mobilization. Turbhe store is an area, a very densely populated slum community in Turbhe, Navi Mumbai. And it's really a typical Bombay suburb, snaking, lanes and by lanes. And of course, it does have piped water supply to houses through NMMC. However, the thing is that this being a slum area, the water pipelines, the gutter lines do run side by side. There are leakages and there are issues which happen, and especially they get even more heightened during monsoon season, where flooding happens and there are a lot more issues that come up. But so we did do pre-launch study, and we did find that there is high incidence of waterborne diseases in this community. Yeah. And then with the support of BASF and NMMC, we set up this community drinking water plant. Yeah. So now when we set up the plant, one of the key things that we knew right up front is that A, the community is getting water in their, either in their homes or very near their homes. So they do not have that kind of, issue. The other thing is that the supply source which NMMC is providing to them is a freshwater source. So that way, again, taste issues do not, they're not like in other areas where, let's say salinity levels, TDS levels are high. There, people really know that the water is unpotable, but here that marker isn't there. And so the risk is actually more invisible to them. And that's why, in a way, it is more challenging, because we have to make them aware of the risk and then tell them that it makes sense to pay a small amount and take good quality water, because in the end it's good for you. So it's not just about the taste of your water. There is a risk in that water. So that was upfront a challenge that we faced. So now let's see what are all the channels, touch points that we need to bring into this program right up front. Of course, first and foremost was the municipal department, because we were doing this in partnership with NMMC. We had them on board right up front. Secondly, we also got in, right in the beginning stages, the local corporator, not so much for actual implementation support, but just to get him to feel that this is part of his community, is being done for his community. And so that, because he's a very, very, people know the corporator more than they would know anyone from NMMC in that community. So it's very important to get his support behind the project right up front. So that is something which we, parallel to speaking with NMMC, we did have multiple meetings with, the local corporator as well, to get his support on the project. And then the other thing we realized is that, again, being in a very densely populated city, it's not easy to get, space to implement your project. And we were getting first a space near a sanitation block, or we were getting on the, highway. And I think for this community, we were very clear that we wanted a space which was very integrated within the community and not outside of the community, because otherwise it is going to really impact, adoption. And took our time, but we, kind of told them that give us either a site on a PHC or give us a site on in one of the municipal schools in that community. So we did reject actually multiple sites before we finally, got them to give us a site within the municipal schools on the boundary of the school ground itself. So that was one thing. And then, of course, we'll get into how we integrated the local PHC, the doctor clinics and Anganwadis and SHGs into it. So this is where we have located it, inside a school premise. As I had mentioned, we were even looking at PHC, but finally located it within the school premise. So it becomes easier to integrate within the community, because you already have one very trusted channel right with you, from implementation stage itself. What it meant was, again, we had multiple meetings with the school board, because they had a few concerns. They had concerns on safety. Then we had to tell them that's absolutely okay. We will, locate ourselves right at the edge of the boundary wall. We can build another separate gate if you want us to, and these are our hours, and, all of that. We gave them a lot of assurances and how our program runs. So in the end, they were assured that yes, they can give us, a small, site within their school ground to put this up. And of course, we told them that right up front that, of course, we will support them with clean water. But also up front, we told them, see, this is something that, safe water, health, these are all aspects that children need to be educated, and we will support you for that. And we told them that, on our walls, we will put up, educational messages. We will do all of that. Give us that space. And in the end, they did agree. And that is something that we have done. So we have ensured that, because it's a school, we put up a lot of facts on water and, water's the risk to health, water in our life, how it plays a role. So we did all of that right, on the plant itself, so that it kind of, and in a way, because it's in the back in their school ground, it made, you know, made it kid friendly, etc., so that it looks more in sync with the school itself. And of course, when we launched this program, we did a lot of interactive activities with the school, interactive sessions. We not only safe water, but also other aspects related to sanitation and hygiene. We did. We held a drawing competition, and when our plant was launched, we ensured that the mayor of Navi Mumbai, who had come for the launch, he was the one who actually gave the prizes to the children. So we made sure that the school was very, very integral part of our entire program, right? From the get-go, we had the school perform during our launch program, and so they really felt that this was part of their school. They almost felt that this is part of our own school's initiative in a way, So that is how we, and through this entire period that our plant has been there, we have been regularly engaging with the school to do some activity or the other, and keep them engaged with us. Again, knowing that it is a challenge in that community to get adoption because of the fact that the taste of water is not an issue. People are not used to buying water previously, that so all of those, there are communities where people are already used to buying water at 20, 30 rupees, and hence this becomes an affordable alternative. Here this wasn't the case, so we really had to work ground up, and that's why right up front, again, we were very, very clear that we have to bring in the PHC into our ecosystem and ensure that we are supporting them, they are supporting us in a way. So what we do is that, we obviously provide them information, pamphlets, etc., which they use to talk about clean water to their patients. And what we also do on our front is that whenever possible, we bring down their team, we give them a platform to reach out to the community. So I think that for their team also, it becomes like, okay, fine, they see us more they see us as part of their ecosystem to build health in that community. So for example, on Women's Day, we got them to give a talk on women's health, what are the measures to take to small tips and things for daily women's health. We got them on sanitation day to address sanitation workers in that area, because there are a lot of community toilets in that area. So we got them, and they were very happy to come and do an entire interactive session, and they brought models, etc., where they could talk about what role of sanitation, how important the role of a sanitation person is in that community, and how health and hygiene are so interlinked, and how their role is so critical to that, and what safety precautions should they take. So this way, we ensure that we are always engaged with them. And apart from using their support, we are also trying to give them a platform to, reach out to the community. Of course, we did a lot of traditional door-to-door exercise, especially around monsoon, because that is the time when it is easiest to tell them about issues in the water. Sometimes you can even tell them that notice your water, it might be brownish. There are many more things that we can explain to them during monsoon. So we especially make sure that prior to monsoons, we do a lot of community door-to-door drives. The other thing is working with local NGOs and SHGs in that area. So we worked with an NGO called Aram, which works in early childcare and early education. So through them, we reached out to parts of the community which were not so close to our plant, and to create awareness and adoption to those. We reached out to local Anganwadis, and then we also ensured that in that area there's a strong sex worker community. So there is a NGO called Alert India, which works with them. So we made sure that we kind of, through that NGO, reached out even to this, marginalized community, so that even they know that something like this exists, and they should, come and avail of these kind of benefits from there. So this is the way we worked with multiple NGOs in that, area. The other thing is that we really look for how is it that we can create opportunities for the community to come together. So whether it is Diwali, whether it is Independence Day or Republic Day, whether it is celebrating the first anniversary or the second anniversary of the plant, we look at how we can bring that community together and, you know, just create a moment of celebration. Because then what happens is that there is that sense of little sense of ownership and engagement, which kind of gets a little more heightened when, you know, they're not just, it's not just a, you know, very professional relationship. We're asking them to kind of, you know, participate in our, you know, little celebrations. So that is something we try and do, you know, occasionally. And again, in that area where we've tied up with street vendors, we, you know, provide them with, you know, clean water from our plant. They use that water for cooking and they, you know, use the same to kind of promote to their clients that, okay, we are using this water. So our food is, you know, hygienically prepared because we are using, you know, filtered water, etc. So those are some of the other initiatives that we've taken. So in this sense, we've really tried to look at all the, you know, touch points in that community and try and make some kind of a shared ecosystem. And so that we can all kind of together have the same, you know, goal or objective. And of course, we regularly meet the NMMC, we meet the local corporator as well. And, you know, so they are fairly updated about what is happening at the, you know, plant. And of course, if there are any issues, then we take it up with them and, you know, ensure that those are resolved. So, and local corporator, we've taken his support also for community awareness initiatives, etc. Yeah, so this is really how we've seen this, you know, this 3-year effort in a way kind of play out. So as I told you, we did have a challenge in the beginning, main challenge being that, you know, they really didn't see the need for it. And that's why the role of, you know, each of those initiatives was critical for us. And that's why we kind of really, you know, made sure that we were building this strong kind of a community network. And we have seen, you know, year on year, good growth in both registration and offtake. Of course, there's still a long way to go. We still know that there's you know, more that can be done and which we will continue to do. But it's a step in the right direction, which is what we're seeing. In terms of the financials, basically, I mean, there is at least, you would say, maybe 5 to 7% of CapEx is spent on this, because there is extensive amount of branding we've done in this plant, especially because we wanted to get the, you know, kids in and, you know, integrated with the school, etc. So there's an extensive amount of branding we've done. We've done a lot of pre-inauguration activities and then, of course, the inauguration. And, of course, the continued IEC that happens. So there is that, you know, I mean, you could say that at least maybe in the initial years, a little higher, in the outer years, a little lower, but on average, 80,000, you know, approximately per annum is what needs to go into, you know, supporting this kind of, and a lot of it, of course, is actually, you can say, senior level time cost, you know, to bring about these, you know, mobilization to happen. So that is something that is required. And of course, ensuring very strong ground people really to implement it. So, yeah. गेल्या 3 वर्षापूर्वी जे पाण्यामुळे जे लोकांना त्रास व्हायचे म्हणजे उलटी वगैरे जुलाब वगैरे ताप वगैरे हे आता ह्या 3 वर्षांनंतर खूप कमी झालेलं आहे आणि आता खूपच म्हणजे टायफॉइड वगैरे जे पेशंट आम्हाला भेटत नाही. ओके थँक्यू. या सो दॅट्स फ्रॉम आर द पीएचसी द डॉक्टर रुपाली फ्रॉम द पीएचसी हर टेस्टिमोनियल. And we also have from the school.
नमस्कार, मी रवींद्र म्हात्रे, शाळा क्रमांक 22 सर्फे स्टोर येथील शिक्षक असून इथे जे पिण्याच्या पाण्याचा प्रोजेक्ट लागलेला आहे तर त्या प्रोजेक्ट मधलं पाणी आम्ही संपूर्ण स्टाफ पितोय. आमचे विद्यार्थी शाळा चालू असताना पित होते, येथील नागरिक सुद्धा पित आहेत. हे पाणी प्यायल्यामुळे कोणत्याही प्रकारचे आजार वगैरे पसरल्याचं आम्हाला अजूनपर्यंत ऐकायला आलेलं नाहीये आणि हे पाणी चांगले असून आम्ही त्याबाबत तसंच आम्ही विद्यार्थ्यांना साथीचे रोग पसरू नये याबाबत हँडवॉश करणे वगैरे जी काळजी घ्यायची असेल ती घ्यायला सांगतो आणि मार्गदर्शन सतत करत असतो. इतरही त्यांचे जे कर्मचारी असतात ते सुद्धा याबाबत मार्गदर्शन हे करत असतात. धन्यवाद.
So thank you very much, Aarti, for this talk. And I would like to say that we have got a large audience, not only from our Seva partners. We have with us one of the, the founding and the oldest donor of Safe Water Network, that is Pentair Foundation. They have been partnering with us since last 12 years. Their CEO is here. And we find a very strong patronage in Ajit Tulo, who's here. And more than the patronage, he has gone to the fields, and we completely understand the sustainability of the project only hinges on and stands upon the buildup of the ecosystem. At this point, I would also like to say, and I'm truly, truly surprised, our CEO, Mr. Kurt Söderlund from US, New York, is a very strong patron of the Seva Pani Pe Charcha talks. He is almost there for all the talks, irrespective of the time. So thank you very much, Kurt. And also thanks to my other teammates who have joined us from New York. But one important thing which has come out from our conversation with Nandi in the community mobilization and with WaterLife in talking about the ecosystem buildup is that wherever there is a very strong community participation and ownership of the water ATM, that plant stands to sustain. And it is the single fundamental change. From Aarti's talk, we gathered that it is very important to have a shared goal, bonding opportunities, celebration of festivals, touching at least 7 or 8 people in the community, and of which you have emphasized the role of corporator very loudly and clearly. So while we all work to get these as a public-private partnership contracts, we find it that the role of the corporator and the local municipal corporation is one of the singular sustainability factor to build the economy. Now, the first question for you, Aarti, is how we understand that 80,000 to 120,000 is the annual budget. How do you factor it in the year 2 and year 3 going forward? Because mostly these tenders, what we get in the PPP mode, are in the L1 category, and getting funding for IEC activities, community mobilization, is almost non-existent. How do you go about this?
So I would say that yes, a large part does happen, you can see, in year 1, where you know there are funds from the implementation stage funds are there. Year 2, year 3, of course, has to come, support from the organization itself. What we do is that, what we find is that it's easier when you have a cluster of plants, because then, you know, the costs get kind of shared across, that IEC cost gets shared across plants. So yes, it is always easier to, mobilize those funds in a cluster rather than in standalone plants. So that is one thing that we've seen. In standalone plants, what we see is that, sometimes we know that, okay, you put in the efforts right now in year 2, year 3, it is going to yield, results. So that time, then the organization has to, in a way, put it in as a, you can say, as an investment for, for the future. So that way, but yes, it is easier to do. Let's say, for example, we have a cluster in Manesar. So that's a cluster of plants. So then their IEC work is easier because of, being in a cluster. Yeah.
So thank you. So cluster principles work in cost reduction and also extended IEC activity. This is very helpful. And what is the org structure for this type of activities, ecosystem buildup in the cluster?
Yeah, so basically in operations, we'll have one, on ground, community mobilization in charge. And beyond that, a lot of mobilization we do get, he or she might drive it, but then a lot of it has to get then driven by the frontline operator, because we need to train the frontline operator to help, you know, integrate with that community and you know, carry out these activities. So our you know, on ground person is there to, you know, kind of mobilize things, but we need very, very strong support from the operator to help you know, in getting these done. And in some cases, of course, we will do it via the local NGOs which are already there in the area and use their you know, structures which are already in place to do it.
There is another question for you, Aarti. And very recently, the government of India has initiated the Catch the Rain program, and Seva is also a very big partner in Catch the Rain program. In the ecosystem buildup, have you done any activity in this zone, Catch the Rain, and how do you go about it?
Yeah. So Catch the Rain, I mean, one of the things that you, we have done on the community level is that, you know, there was this video of Catch the Rain, which has been, you know, the Piku video, which has been prepared by, you know, the ministry. So we have actually gone to the schools and given them that video. And because nowadays everything is online still. So, but we have told them that this really needs to be disseminated via, because they are doing it, you know, school is still happening online. So via online mediums, they should disseminate this medium, this video. So that is one of the things that we're doing to support Catch the Rain, so that we're ensuring that, you know, beyond just our plant. At our plant, of course, we have our posters and all of that. We talk to them about Catch the Rain. We, you know, ask them what their feelings about how rain is important. But beyond that, we are, you know, going to the schools and, you know, ensuring that we are passing on this message.
Amit from Janajal wants to know, in your community mobilization and ecosystem buildup, what are the things that did not work? And what was the thing which most worked, so that we can draw lessons how to go about it?
Okay. So, okay. What I would say, what really worked, I for sure, is the school and the PHC support. What also really worked was the corporator support, because, you know, I mean, sometimes small local issue, NMMC, I mean, is the, you know, too big to get into any small local issues. So we know that corporator support then is required to kind of just resolve these, you know, things which sometimes come up. So those elements really did work. What we had also tried was trying to see if, you know, through NGOs and SHGs, whether we can also, you know, set up distribution systems. And we did actually pilot some of those as well, because we thought they're already there in that community. They have the, you know, the wherewithal to do that. They, you know, so, but that is something that didn't work. I think that distribution challenge is quite different from community mobilization challenge. And so that probably we still need to kind of work on it and make that happen. But that is something we did try, and it didn't, you know, we were not able to leverage those existing channels to help us with the distribution part.
There's one more question for you. With so many clusters, you are talking about water ATMs being set up in a cluster for you to get the sustainability with respect to HR, which is basically financing your own team. What is the number of water ATMs that you are required for sustainability? And the NGOs which are working in your locality, are they giving their services pro bono, or how are you? Are you compensating them? What's the method of engagement?
Okay, so two things. One is, I think if you have, in this case, of course, this is a standalone plant, but in general, if you have at least around, you know, 8 to 12 ATMs in a cluster, then that is great, because then your, you know, your IC costs do get, you know, I mean, you are able to kind of maximize, you know, whatever you put in. In terms of engaging with NGOs, we have done both, actually. What we've seen is, partnering with them to create awareness, you know, through talking to them, using that platforms to talk to their you know, whoever they are working with, that is pretty much pro bono. We've never had to have any kind of financial thing for that. However, if we are expecting them to do a little beyond that, which is actually help with, you know, door-to-door exercise or registration exercise, then we have actually then said ki we will, you know, kind of compensate you for it. But yeah, I mean, again, the challenge I would say is ki most NGOs are very happy and willing to kind of provide their platforms to us pro bono, absolutely no issue. But to kind of help or take their help to go beyond that sometimes is challenging, and then we have to build in some compensation.
So thank you for this. We heard you say that you are reaching out to marginalized community, and I think this is for the first time, at least I have heard. I do not know about my other partners, and this is a question from me, that you are reaching out to sex workers. And I think they are the most marginalized and the most taboo associated communities. What challenges did you see the other members posing to you when you engaged with them, and how was their acceptance, and was any strategy deployed to bring them on board and at the same time teach the regular user that there has to be an acceptance, because this we find is one of the biggest divider in development of the ecosystem.
Yeah. So, okay, in this particular case, we did not face too much of a challenge in that respect. We were able to reach out to them. I don't think that there was too much of a issue in, faced, for them to come and collect water. So that challenge we didn't really face in this particular case. But yes, there have been communities where based on, there could be a caste-based, challenge that we have faced. And there then it has been, in fact, a little more challenging. We have to sit with, and have extended talks with the panchayat, bring them on board, really get their support. And also it could be, other challenges. So it's really about saying that we are just a neutral party. We are not, we are here for the benefit of everyone, and kind of projecting that kind of an approach does help. But yeah, those are, in some places easier to kind of go through, some places they are more challenging, I think. Yeah.
May I ask Anand Rudra to speak a few sentences, share his opinions about the topic?
Yeah, thank you so much, Aarti, for sharing the experience of Water Life, as well as Poonamji for yet another great episode of the Water Champions sharing their thoughts and their life experiences with everybody. Thanks, Kurt. Thanks to others who have joined from across the various other geographical sites. And I know, despite the time zone difference, you have taken the time out to join us. I think I felt very much enamored with Aarti's presentation, because I think she covered it practically all, which I and Poonamji have been talking about. What do we do with just water ATMs? And one of the first things that came up was, okay, water ATMs just give water. That's what it's meant to be. That's what the business is in which I think all the small water enterprises are in. But I think what Poonamji and the Seva program is doing for the last year and a half is to basically make this as something more of a resource which is multifaceted. And Aarti, you have shared what Water Life is doing exactly on those lines. It's just not about water and drinking water. You have also mentioned about how you're reaching out to communities, you're working with women of different groups, which are further reaching out to the marginalized. And I've worked in the HIV sector. I understand what and how difficult issues are to basically make things different in a mindset. And finally, the element of what you basically also touched about, using the water ATMs as lighthouses for sharing information during the current COVID times. I think that's a godsend thing that you are all doing. And I think, thank you, Aarti. Thank you, everybody else who's part of this effort under Poonamji's guidance, that the water ATMs are shaping up as multifaceted, multi-resourceful, pragmatic, you know, like opportune. These are things which are significant as we speak. COVID has not gone away. I'm not saying that this is a thing of the past, but the fact that you are using this platform to tell people about this issue amongst so many others, I think it's really hats off to everybody who's taken the time and the effort to do so. Last but not the least, the element, Aarti, that you brought in beautifully in your presentation is the element of testimonials. And that's one thing I have worked continuously in my 3 decades of work in the development sector is, if others don't talk about you, whatever you tell actually is 50% of what basically is of meaning to others. You know, somebody as a third partner, a third party has to talk about you. And I think the testimonials brought that message clear, loud and sound. And I think Poonamji, under her guidance, has been messaging exactly this, that others should be talking about you 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line. And that came out very nicely in the testimonials, both from the PHC. Why? Because that's the health connection. From the school, why? Because that's the school children's connection. And I'm sure the Mumbai Corporation also would be saying the same words, Aarti. So I think little doubt about how this is going to be a excellent model. And given an opportunity, I would love actually with Poonamji to pay a visit to one of your sites to see this along with the country's, you know, like our team, which is working with the government on the Jal Jeevan Mission and the Swachh Bharat Mission, because both of them have things to learn from everybody. As I say, nothing is basically perfect. Even the teams are not perfect the way we have. So overall, congratulations, well done. And thank you, Poonamji, for bringing in yet another great episode of Water Champions in this episode of Pani Pe Charcha. Great work. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Anandji. Thank you to all my partners. Thank you, everybody.